done. Lord Jesus Christ, your power make known, for you are Lord of Lords alone. The Holy Church, that we may sing your praise eternally. Please stand. We turn to page 260 in the front part of your Lutheran hymnal. Page 260, we continue with the service of prayer and preaching. This is the day which the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
From the rising of the sun to its setting.
The name of
the Lord is to be praised. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God then dwell in the tents of the wicked. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Sanctify us in your truth. Your word is truth. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The Lord God is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. With joy of you draw water from the wells of salvation. And you will say in that day, give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the peoples, proclaim that his name is exalted. The Lord God is my strength and my song, and he my salvation. Sing praises to the Lord, for he has done gloriously. Let this be known in all the earth. Shout and sing for joy, O Zion, for great in your midst is the Holy One of Israel. The Lord God is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, forever. Amen. The Lord God is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation.
You may be seated for our readings.
Our first lesson for today is taken from Acts chapter 10. Peter opened his mouth and said, "Truly I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. As for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. You yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee after the baptism that John proclaimed, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem, They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and made him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. While Peter was still saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word, and the believers from among the circumcised who had come with Peter were amazed, because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles. For they were hearing them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter declared, "Can anyone withhold water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked him to remain for some days. This is the word of the Lord. Our epistle lesson is taken from 1 John chapter 5. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God. And everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of him. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and obey his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, not by the water only, but by the water and the blood, and the Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. For there are three that testify, the Spirit and the water and the blood, and these three agree. This is the word of the Lord. Would you turn now to Psalm 148 in the front part of your hymnal? Psalm 148. We will speak Psalm 148 half verse by half verse. Psalm 148. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, you highest heavens.
And you are above the heavens.
Let them praise the name of the Lord. For he commanded, and they were created. And he established them forever and ever. He gave a decree, and it shall not pass away. Praise the Lord from the earth, you great sea creatures and all deeps. Fire and hail, snow and mist, stormy wind fulfilling his word. Mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars, beasts and all livestock, creeping things and flying birds, kings of the earth and all peoples, princes and all rulers of the earth, young men and maidens together, old men and children, let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His majesty is above earth and heaven. He has raised up a horn for his people, praise for all his saints. For the people of Israel who are near to him, praise the Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Would you please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel? The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 15th chapter. Jesus said, "As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lays down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you, so that you will love one another. This is the word of the Lord. We turn to our responsory found on page 263. We speak the common responsory. Forever, O Lord, your word is firmly set in the heavens. And the place where your glory dwells. Blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it. Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Lord, I love the habitation of your house, and the place where your glory dwells. We speak together the Ten Commandments. You shall have no other gods. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. Honor your father and your mother. You shall not murder. You shall not murder. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. If you would, with me, turn to page 322 in the front part of your hymnal. Page 322, our catechism section to reflect on today, along with our readings and our sermon, is taken from the close of the commandments found on page 322, the bottom left-hand corner. The close of the commandments. What does God say about all these commandments? He says, I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to a thousand generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. What does this mean? God threatens to punish all who break these commandments. Therefore, we should fear his wrath and not do anything against them. But he promises grace and every blessing to all who keep these commandments. Therefore, we should also love and trust in him and gladly do what he commands. You may be seated for our sermon hymn.
Testifying to the one whose death defying life has come with life for all. In a watery grave are buried all our sins that Jesus carried. The ark of life has ferried us across death's raging flood. Dark the way, yet Christ precedes us. Past the scowl of death he leads us, spreads a table where he feeds us with his body and his blood.
Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God, our Father, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I don't know about you, but I struggled with today's gospel lesson. It distressed me. I know that might sound strange, but it's true. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Well, I struggle and worry when I hear these words because I know the cold, ugly truth of my life. I am not so foolish to believe that I can actually keep or even come close to keeping this command of Jesus. I know the truth. I do not love others the same way Jesus loves me. What bothers me more, however, than the mere knowledge that I sometimes disobey or often willfully disobey my Lord's command to love is the fact that Jesus puts this command or this conditional statement together with an if statement. You are my friends if you do what I command you. But I don't do what my Lord commands. Worse yet, I sometimes don't keep his command on purpose. There are some people I just don't want to love. They're mean, they're nasty, they're sneaky and two-faced, and sometimes they live in other countries and they persecute our brothers and sisters in Christ. I could go on and on for all sorts of reasons and justifications I have for not loving certain people. In the end, it comes down to a simple fact. I don't want to love them. But if I don't love them, I don't keep his command, then Jesus is not my friend. That's what he tells us. And it never turns out well in the end. Maybe you can understand why it bothered and distressed me. But maybe the problem isn't the words of Jesus. Of course it isn't. It isn't his gospel. Maybe the problem is me, with my understanding and perception of these words. You see, all too often we tend to treat these words as law. We hear the word command and our old Adam bolts upright and says, here's something we need to do. And I'll admit, it's hard to get around this mindset in this particular text. We need to abide in Jesus. We need to love others in the same perfect, unconditional way that he loves us. Basically, we need to follow and copy and emulate Jesus. And if we don't, there are conditions. If we don't do all these things, we won't be Jesus' friends. But there's the problem. The whole rationale and reasoning is focused on us and what we need to do. I must love others like Jesus loves me in order to be saved. But is that what Jesus gave us? Is that what he taught us? Is that his command? Maybe we should let Jesus speak for himself. He says later in our text, these things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. Maybe I should point out the fact that Jesus was speaking these words to his apostles mere hours before he was betrayed, beaten, spat upon, and nailed to a criminal's cross. My joy may be in you and your joy may be full. As I said, all too often we hear these words and these commands of Christ and we pull them out of the scriptures, we pull them out of context, and we turn them into do this or else, rather than the gospel Jesus intended it to be. When Christ is speaking these words, he's speaking them to his apostles, knowing full well what is in store for him and what's in store for them as well. In fact, within an hour or so, he will be speaking these words about, within an hour of speaking these words about joy and love, he will be in the Garden of Gethsemane praying and sweating great drops of blood as he asks his Father to take this cup of suffering away from him. He knows what's coming. It's in the midst of this anguish, in the midst of knowing all the pain and suffering and abandonment and denial that awaits him, that Jesus tenderly instructs his apostles, the very men who would abandon him and forsake him and deny him and lose all hope and trust in him. That is love. Greater love has none than this, that someone lays down his life for his friends. You are my friends. Jesus is telling his disciples in no uncertain terms how much he loves them. And just a few hours, in the midst of all that gloom and doom and despair, he's going to practice what he preaches, showing them and the entire world just how much he loves them by laying down his life as a ransom in exchange for our lives. Jesus showed his amazing unconditional love for everyone by taking the Father's righteous anger and wrath upon himself. Now, despite what the world might tell you, despite what the news might tell you, everyone, every man, woman, and child conceived from Adam has earned and deserved the full wrath and fury of God's judgment. But out of a love that only God himself could have, he took that full divine wrath and fury and judgment upon himself. He was judged and condemned in our place, and that is love. But Pastor, that doesn't make things better. Actually, it makes things worse. Only Jesus can have this kind of love. How can we love him if only he can have that kind of love? Well, you're absolutely right. Only Jesus has that perfect kind of love. Unconditional, self-giving, self-sacrificial love. Moms come close, probably the closest we get in this world. There's a story that I'd maybe like to share with you. There was a John Wayne Gacy's mother visited him on death row as often as she could. Now, those of you who don't know who John Wayne Gacy was, he was a serial killer. He was a bad guy, real bad guy, monster. And the people would ask his mother, the news crews, the media, even her friends and family would ask, why do you go see him? Why don't you just abandon him? Why don't you just say, I'm done with him. I forsake him. I don't want to be around him ever again. And she says, he's my son. I still love him. What am I supposed to do? Not love my son? I will always love him. But even her love had limits. She developed Alzheimer's and died a few years into John Wayne Gacy's incarceration, leaving him alone on death row. Even this unbelievable example of love from a mother still has conditions, conditions of human health and wellness, conditions that affect us all. But that is a reason for joy for us. The love that Christ has for us has no conditions. No conditions of health, wellness, mood, distance, economic conditions, or factors, any factors that make us sometimes not want to love one another. Maybe you don't like someone's personality. Maybe you don't like someone, how they look at the world, or their political party they're affiliated with, or whatever that thing may be. There is no such if-then conditional statements for Jesus. He loves everyone the same. Our Lord's love for us is so great that the gates of hell could not prevail against it. The grave, the devil, and all of hell's fury could not keep the Lord of life from rising again. The love of God willingly went into hellish exile of death and forsakenness for us, leading us back out into life on his victorious, resurrected shoulders. It is this love that we have been baptized into, not because we did anything to deserve adoption and salvation, but because his love for us is that great and incomprehensible. Now, in the light of all this, it's hard not to have joy. Even in the midst of whatever sorrow or worry you have, no matter how bad life gets, you are loved by Christ. Loved so much that he died and rose for you, and that's what this command about Jesus is all about. He speaks these words not to get us focused on what we need to do in order to be saved, but in order to direct our focus on what he has done in order to save us and all people. That's just it. When your focus, your faith, is centered on and focused on the amazing unconditional love of Christ, you can't help but recognize each and every one of your fellow brothers and sisters as people whom Christ died and gave his blood for. So maybe that person that you have a problem with, that person whom you don't like their personality or their political leanings, you might look at them anew and see the blood of Christ that bought them from sin and damnation as well. It is this unconditional Christian love, this agape love that Christ speaks of throughout the entire Gospel of John, beginning all the way back at John 3:16, that is made complete in us by loving one another just as Christ loved us. Understanding the love of Christ by looking around and seeing everyone that we see on this planet as someone whom Christ loves equally. It's a great love, isn't it? It's a love that goes beyond our abilities to love. It's a love that transcends our failings and our problems. We see the love of Christ in each other, how much he loved each and every one of us. Christ intentionally speaks a theological passive here. The Greek does a much better job of explaining this concept than the English. I think that's where kind of the disconnect happens. The Christ intentionally speaks a theological passive verb here. We don't make our joy full or complete ourselves. We can't do that, not even a little bit. We have no power or ability to do that any more than we have the power to make apple trees grow good apples. Our joy, the joy of Christ, is made full in us by Christ. As St. Paul says to the Galatians, I have been crucified with Christ, which is what baptism is. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Maybe we might say it another way. I have been baptized, crucified into Christ. It is no longer I who love, but that Christ speaks of, but Christ who lives and loves within me. Your love and joy that Christ speaks about is his love and joy that he brings to completion in you. Through the working of his Holy Spirit, by his means of grace, he brings this joy to completion and fullness in you and through you. I believe that I cannot, by my own reason or strength, believe in my Lord Jesus Christ or come to him. Apart from me, you can do nothing. How true is this? Apart from Christ, there is no fullness of joy. There will always be a Jesus-shaped hole, rather, in our heart. There will always be incompleteness and void. And guess what? Nature abhors a vacuum. There can never be a void for very long, which is why man is always trying to fill that Jesus-shaped hole in our hearts with all kinds of other things. Things we think will bring us joy. More money, more vacations, more power, new cars, new clothes, new phones, more and more and more. But it never takes long to figure out that a Christ-less, cross-less joy is no joy at all. At best, it will always be imperfect and lacking and discontented and dying. It's precisely because of this that I point you to the love of Christ Jesus. The love that he had for you in his life, death, and resurrection. The love that he still shows you today by coming to you to feed you and nourish you with his life-giving, joy-inducing gifts of body, blood, grace, mercy, and peace. I guess you could call it a command of sorts. Look here, listen here, trust in this, take and eat, take and drink. You can call all those statements commands. You could even go so far as to call them law, the law of liberty, as James refers to it in his epistle. But understand this, law and command God gives you not to threaten you or to scare you or to cause you to despair, but to give you joy and peace in believing. He gives you this command and law of love in order to fix your focus on him, the sole font and source of your forgiveness, your salvation, your everlasting peace. Look here, listen here, trust in this. May this love of God, love made flesh for you and hung on a cross to die for you, grant you the full intended measure of his peace and joy all your remaining days. And may Christ's joy and peace be witnessed in you and through you as it spills over in abundance to all those whom God has brought in contact with you. May your cup of his joy and peace ever and always be overflowing. In the name of Jesus Christ, who loves us. Amen. We now have our offering. Please stand for prayer. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the gift of divine peace and of pardon, with all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Christian Church here and scattered throughout the world, and for the proclamation of the gospel and the calling of all to faith, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this nation, for our cities and communities, and for the common welfare of us all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For seasonable weather and for the fruitfulness of the earth, Lord, especially we thank you for the rains that you have given to us. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who labor, for those whose work is difficult or dangerous, and for all who travel, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all those in need, for the hungry and homeless, for the widowed and orphaned, and for all those in prison, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the sick, the injured, and the struggling, especially remember Reverend Shane, Janet, Virginia, Clifford, Jean, Karen, and Tom. We also remember Roger, Brian, Ann, Nathan, Charlotte, Caleb, Jack, Bill, Marlis, Brayton, Byron, Andrea, Lee, Janet, and Al. We remember those who are dying and those who have passed. We remember all those who mourn those who have passed. Especially we pray for the family of Helen Shun, who continue to mourn her loss this past week. We also pray for all Christians in our world who are persecuted, just for proclaiming Christ as their Lord and Savior. Today, especially remember the Christians who are persecuted in Qatar, Syria, Egypt, and Iraq. We also remember our brothers and sisters in Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea that continue to deal with the after effects and the difficulties, the sickness of Ebola. We pray for all those who care for them as well. Let us pray to the Lord. We pray for our Lutheran School Association, both for our grade school and our high school. They bring to an end many things this week and next week with teachers' meetings and things like that. Lord, we pray for a blessed end to the school year, a positive end to the school year, and that the students and the staff there would be blessed with your grace and your mercy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for all mothers on this day of Mother's Day. We thank you so much that you've given us mothers in this world to take care of us as children. Lord, it is a blessed reminder of the great love that you have for us. An imperfect reminder, but a reminder of the great love that you have for us. We thank and bless you for all mothers in this world. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. We also remember all mothers who have lost children and all women who have not had the blessed joy of being able to be a mother. Mother's Day can be a very wonderful day and can be a very difficult day. We remember all those mothers who mourn, especially remember Teresa, who lost both of her children a year ago, and this is a very difficult day for her. We pray, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. We remember also with thanksgiving the gift that you have given us in President Sackast and Debbie Sackast, both being members of our congregation and also being blessed leaders, leader of our South Dakota district. We thank you for their service, and we ask that you would bless them in this transitional time, moving back to the city of Huron, and all the difficulties that go with moving. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Finally, for these and for all our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. We turn to our bulletin, and we speak together the collect of the day. O God, the giver of all that is good, by your holy inspiration, grant that we may think those things that are right, and by your merciful guiding, accomplish them. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Blessed Lord, you have caused all Holy Scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, learn, and take them to heart, that by the patience and comfort of your Holy Word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. We pray together Luther's morning prayer. I thank you, my Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger, and I pray this day also from sin and every evil. To your hands I commend myself, my body and soul, and all things, and that always you will be with me, and that the evil soul may have no power over me. Amen. Christ has been raised from the dead. Alleluia, alleluia. The Passover lamb has been sacrificed. Raised from the dead, he will never die again. Death has no more dominion over him. Christ has been raised from the dead. Alleluia, alleluia. Dying, Christ dies to sin once for all. Living, he lives to God. Count yourselves as dead to the sin and alive to God. In Christ Jesus our Lord, Christ has been raised from the dead. Alleluia. This time I'd ask President Sackast and Debbie to come forward. Beloved in the Lord, in holy baptism, you became a member of the Holy Christian Church and our Lord's Word and Sacraments. and have nourished, we have nourished you as this congregation for, how many years has it been now? 9 years. Well, it's new to me. As we bid you farewell and Godspeed, hear the words of the Apostle Paul. I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you, all making my prayer with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. And I'm sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. The Lord be with you and also with you. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we give thanks that you have so faithfully nourished our brother and sister with us in the communion of this congregation. Bless, protect, and defend them as they now depart from us. Preserve them in the confession of your name and in loving service to others. Keep us in fellowship with all your saints and bring us at last to the joys of your heavenly kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. My only regret in that you're leaving is that I didn't have more of a chance to get to know you. That's the only bad thing about this whole thing. It's been a pleasure knowing you for the short time that I've known both of you. So we are very sad to see you go, of course, but very happy for what lies in the future for both of you. Thank you. Mary, may you sit down. Turn to our hymnal. Let us bless the Lord. The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve you all. Amen. We are seated for our closing hymn.
And griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. Carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. The Lord in prayer. Oh, and we find a friend so faithful, who will all our sorrows share. Jesus knows our every weakness. Thou to the Lord in prayer.
Stick and put little candles out.
Oh, spies forsake thee. Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find a solace there.
Good morning. Lord's blessings be with all of you. It's so nice to have you. I know it was we were a little worried about what was going to happen while we were here, and maybe some of you worried like we're going to pull our cars in the parking lot, and then as soon as we get in the church, there's going to be a hailstorm on all the cars. But it turned out okay. It just got a good shot of rain this morning, and that was well welcomed. Several announcements this morning that make note of. We'll be recognizing our high school graduates next week at the 8 o'clock service. And then there are a couple of open houses. Luis Martinez is having his open house this upcoming Saturday downstairs in the Church Fellowship Hall from 11 to 3, as well as Rosemary is having her open house on Sunday, May 17th from 11:30 to 2:30. The address is there. I point those out because they are both inviting the entire congregation to be present, so you're more welcome to join us. Please don't forget we have a kind of an important voters meeting on the 31st of May, which is the weekend after Memorial Day weekend, so hopefully we should have good attendance. The women are starting a new Bible study. Softball team is getting ready. Pastor Morfitt is going to take off and try to continue on Revelation today. For those of you who are attending the Revelation Bible study, he's going to take a little time to get to know everybody and maybe figure out how we're going to teach in class. But he is going to be continuing that Revelation Bible study today, as well as I will be doing Bible study. But we're going to go downstairs and have a cake reception for the SACcast. So we'll do that first, and then we'll get a feel for when things are when people have had enough cake, and then we'll go and do a Bible study. There are other announcements. Don't forget the youth is going on the 21st to Valley Fair. That'll be kind of a big trip. And Camp Minneboji is the 14th to the 20th of June. I think those forms and the money for that camp need to be in fairly soon. So please keep that on your front burner there. And don't forget the golf tournament as well for the Lutheran High School. That is a very good fundraiser for them. Looks like there's a hole-in-one prize of $10,000. So that would be a decent thing to win. So you should go be part of it. It'd be fun. My dad had this really crazy idea once about how to encourage offerings at the church. He called it the Lutheran Lotto. This is a crazy idea. And what he said was, every Sunday they pick one random envelope out of the offering plate, and they would give the person back three times what they put in, you see. So then that's a way to encourage. This is my father. He's crazy, right? He's nuts. He's a funny guy, though. You should get to know him. He's pretty funny. That was a joke, by the way. He never would have done that. Finally, we have a special bulletin insert for President Sackass, retirement ceremony, which will be May 31st at 5 p.m. in Huron at Mount Calvary. It is an open invitation to anyone in the congregation, anyone from the district who would like to attend. There is one caveat that you should call this district office or email Julie Pike to let her know that you're planning on attending. So that she can make plans, the Huron can make plans for meals for people there. So we are also doing a special offering. If you look to the third paragraph here of that insert, the board of directors on behalf of the district is planning to give President and Debbie Sackass a trip to Germany, visit the Luther sites and the sites of the Lutheran Reformation. We are doing a special offering then. So we can do this one of two ways. There are envelopes in the narthex that go straight to the district office. If you'd like to grab one of those and send your offering in at another time, that is fine. Or if you'd like to get a card, fill it out, and put your offering in that way, you may give them to me, and I'll take them with me when I go to the service on May 31st, and then there'll be a place to give those to President Sackass that way. It would be very nice, I think, to honor his 9 years of very dedicated service, both him and his wife, because I know it takes two people to make these things work. You can't do it on your own. Having been there, have you guys been to Germany? Oh, well, it's a wonderful thing, and every pastor should do it once at least. If you can help, if you can in any way support that effort, I would greatly encourage you to do so. We'll be having cake for the SACcast then, immediately following a service downstairs in the fellowship hall. Lord's blessings to you as we continue this kingdom work in his kingdom field.
Mm-hmm.